Rock, and everything we do is a lot of problems. So when don't think, well, we approach it the same way, and I can tell you that from now 5 years of research, I don't think anybody has really approached it from a truly logical standpoint. But this is what it boils down to. It's going to be either a modern hope, or it's a genuine artifact. John says 1362, so if it is genuine, the language and everything else that's in that inscription must be consistent with that. Obviously, as a geologist, my work focused primarily on the geology, especially early on, and I've talked to you about that, and it indicates that the stone is very old. Therefore, based on my logic exercise, number one, the language, the grammar, and the rules must be consistent with 14th century. If the weather is old, that means it's genuine, and therefore these things must be so. And then we'll talk about that. For decades, the so-called scholars were wrong, because they said the language wasn't consistent. And I said this 5 years ago before I even knew this, I said, well, I don't care what they say. Based on this is true. The scholars can't have it right if they say it's not 14th century. They must be wrong. The other thing that must be is if it's genuine, because of the geology told me that, the history of Scandinavia in North America must fit with a plausible scenario for the Kensington Limestone to be here in Kensington. And it may touch on that too. But there has to be an explanation. And I think sometimes people forget about that. I've heard all kinds of people say, well, gee, they couldn't have got this. That's not evidence, that's an opinion. Not very well informed opinion in my opinion either, but the fact is that the history has to be consistent if it's genuine. There must be an explanation somewhere. And because Old Holman said he didn't do it, geology said the goal, it means, based on logic, that he was telling the truth. No question about that in my mind. So we're going to segue into the language. We've talked about the geology, the documents, we've talked about the Roman family. Now we're going to talk about the solutions. Dick's going to talk about the solutions, but I just want to explain something that I did well back in 2002, starting in April. And as part of my business, one of the things that we do when we do an analysis is we document things. We record measurements, we observe things, we take measurements, and we just record the data. And one of the things we do, and Dick was on to this as well, we need a photograph and look very carefully at the entire inscription. Before you can do any kind of analysis of the language or the room, you need to know what's there. So we did this. And starting with the very first rune, which was the first character, which was number, I started to find some very unexpected things, like punch marks on the line of many of the characters. And there were some punch marks outside the line, but both of them were within the line. I also found some very unusual short strokes. And you can see a little split here in the bottom of this rune. This is the only thorn rune that we're going to talk about in a second that has that. And as a geologist, really knew nothing about the language at that time, I was informed that this was never seen before. So I said, well, how the heck did anybody talk about the language if they don't know what's there? They didn't know about this. And again, I don't know what that is. But there are two things that are undeniable about these marks that we're going to talk about. One is that they're intentional and they mean something. And we're into 3.5, almost 4 years, Dick and I were wondering about what these things could be. And Dick Wilson is going to tell you about what we believe these things are. There could be another interpretation of what he's about to explain, there's no question about that. But again, from a logical standpoint, whatever the explanation is for these mysterious marks, they have to be sensible, reasonable, and plausible. That makes sense. And we think this explanation makes sense. You guys can decide yourself. I'd like to introduce Dick Nielsen, my partner for the last 5 years in this project, and an amazing guy. So, Dick, here you go.
Thank you, John. going to speak about the details of my meeting today, but I just want to say that I wrote a paper in 1998, which was reviewed by Dr. Smith in Oslo, where he made the following statement. He said, define imagination, that these 16 words of the Ten Lindstone should be the first evidence of these words in the standardization language. He said, simply would not, defy the statistics of that to be true. Well, what often happens, people frame the argument, you didn't go far enough, you didn't say, however, the information that we need to look at to establish these words is not yet published. What happened in Denmark and Norway is a lot of the language information was published very early, but the Swedish information is not yet published. So today we have a situation where Ida Holland would say that all the modern things in Danish that we see today occurred by 1350. Likewise, in Norway, the professors say the same thing, that the modern traits in the Norwegian language occurred in the language by 1350. Those are different in Sweden. They're different in Sweden because the very documents that need to be examined were not examined in the period of 1350. 1400. The very community that pertains to making income, we thought based off 1362. Well, I decided to look into these moments which have been published in the last 50 years to begin to establish if it really truly is intentional income, the first evidence of these words in Scandinavian language. Well, it turns out that none of them are intentional income in the first evidence. They occur in components that have since been published, such as Lindstrom and others, in the period 1350 to 1375. I have some of these components here. And in here you find these 16 words that Dr. Pinnert was concerned about in the diploma. The diploma is nothing but letters. It's the Latin term for legal documents purchase of land, deeds of trust, things like that. So, I'm just saying, if we don't have to go into details, that argument has fallen in the last 7 years. And he just gave me a laundry list of words to search. So, there are other things, though, that we're going to talk about today that are absolutely new. We don't have a light left. Including the English word from dead, spelled in the east, not in the A, in the west. He's always been accused of having something to farmer. We learned today that his son hardly spoke English. I don't know if all the woman spoke much English, but he certainly mixed those words in the Scandinavian lingo. And what several fails to point out was that the dialect on the Scandinavian lingo was not in the dialect of the usual suspects, the Kensington, that is local bias, Anderson, Olin, and even Doug Graham. Now, one of the first things that Scott determined for me was that we have a double box in this word. It proves out what we do. Up to this time, except for 50 years ago, this word is considered they are, meaning have, that was definitely not an easy word. It was a very difficult one for me and others to try to find out how that could be medieval. And if it turned out to be hard, then it was proof that it was a modern artifact. But it turns out, it proves the opposite. Har is a very special facility. I have found it three times in the 2000 diplomas on the book back. Three times, but it doesn't fit spelled that way in these very documents I showed you earlier. But it begs the question, how on earth did that get on the head of the Lindstrom? And all we've only learned about this word in the diplomas since area in Norway and Sweden. There are some people on the island areas in Denmark. Denmark is not considered to be the source of the expedition, which says there are 80 bombs, 22 Norwegians on an acquisition trip far west from Finland. They had a camp one day by two in the woods that's not really known, Salah, one day journey north from the stone. They continued to say, we went fishing one day. After we came home, we found 10 men red with blood and death. Then it says that odd ABM, we'll get into that, it may be odd over it, may not be. Then it proceeds to say that we have 10 men by the sea that can also be in the light. 14 days travel from the island. And then finalizes with the term year 1352. So, early on, we identified Gotland as probably the source of the rune, whether it was according to language or maybe the same. In this full time, each of them, there is this, but each Gotland, as you can say, and Gotland were in the same diocese. That meant that they were under the same bishop as in Sweden. Gotland had 90 churches, far more churches than maybe population could supply priests for. So many of them came to Gotland from future Gotland, and we do have a mixture of language from the future Islam, in case room traced from both of these areas as well as language traced from both of these areas. Presently, the people in the past 100 years who said the future Islam was a hope. Frame the argument again. They would say that that the solar wind, which we'll talk about later, could proceed, and therefore this word on the Kedrinthum of Gaddafi stood for discovery. Then they would say, yeah, discovery is a modern word, and this could be Kedrinthum is false. They frame the argument by saying that the solar wind stood for D. It's not fantasy. It stood for THFT, and the word is apodica, a legitimate old Greek word meaning acquisition. It fits pretty well into what they probably did, acquired land, furs, or whatever. And of course, Henrik Williams, and I have written a paper about that, and Henrik Williams, top Scandinavian scholar at Uppsala University in Sweden, and he agrees on this point. And there's one of the key reasons that he might have worked with him on the language of Kedrinthum. He considered that a completely big breakthrough that turned all the issues on their head. And certainly it did. But it was in the dictionary from the beginning. From the very beginning of the preference, no one looked at it. The compelling evidence, which was, I would have liked a title like Starfish. But look at this beautiful dialogue. It says in Scandinavian, if I translate it, the feathers of the eagle are four. Can you guys on the phone go and say those lucky birds? The phone head, and these people are not speaking, they're actually saying what they want to be. This was discovered in 1938 in Lund, the present day Sweden. This one here was discovered in 1935. This is out of our. And of course, they have something that's very important. It's saying, your prayer, God, your prayer, religion is on their mind, no question about it. This is out of our, the Kedrinthum. Scotland and I discovered only in December this year. It's in the word bar. It's exactly where a dotted R belongs. Now, I'll tell you what a dotted R is. It's palatable. The evidence when we started showed that everyone believed that the palatable appears in Scandinavian language around 1200. Turns out that Island of Gotland is very isolated in the backwater, that it continues to be used into the 1400s. Not only correctly in the word, but definitely used. Stick your tongue to the roof of your mouth, which is your palate. Get up to the taste of your food, and you say, try to say, ah, error. I think I'd get your attention if I said something. So the word, like, you, means I off, okay? But it's not the palate off. So if I wanted to get my children's attention, I would say, ew! That's part of what we do today, I said. So that came out of the language. But this is a weird respect to find this. This is, after 100 years of trying to find the smoking gun to prove the case that it was modern, no one looked for the smoking gun to prove that it was medieval. And this is it. They're on the hook. Documented, not even known before the 1930s. 40 years after the smoking gun was found. And it's not the only gun at all, but it's medieval. I know you've been waiting for this. Scotland. Heavy German population. This was one of the ancient cities for trade. In 1300, it's a very important place. During this time, starting in the mid-12th century, there was one crusade after the other, so 1350, driving the heathen Slavs away from the southern coast of the Baltic Sea. They used to have pirate raids on the Christian Scandinavia. So, suddenly we had the presence of templars and their successes of Teutonic Knights and a heavy concentration of the Cistercians, monks, allied to the templars that were founded by Saint Bernard out of France from Burgundy and Lorraine, heavy German, French influence. We said, well, I don't think it's go back one more time, Scott. So, runes and scriptures. The first one was found in Lincoln here. The other one is Lincoln. Lincoln was the cathedral city of Scandinavia in up until 1200, when they had a cathedral in Uppsala. But Lincoln was on the way from Gotland to Lincoln here. So, it's interesting that the late presence of the god of Ars is in the southern coast of Sweden in the Baltic, and only this. Here's Scotland. Now, I thought you said you went to 90 churches. This only looks like about 60.
Some of them were interesting.
Scott, who, writes, he's not a churchgoer, ended up in about 80 churches in 10 days in Scotland. And I've heard some of the reports that, he was on his knees. He claimed to the many etchings of the runic inscriptions that are on the floor.
I'll never tell.
And my claim is praying on the lawn. But these are beautiful churches, and they're one of them, very high. And we began to see Templar cross. Okay? This is a stylized M, WM. You're on your knees, right?
One.
Okay. Now back to then. This is a room church. This is the church of the Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit. It's octagonal. This is what it looks like. Notice we have M and W. We drove here last night and passed all of them, and we were delighted to see this beautiful church to the north of 94 has eight sided people like this, and it has this kind of dog and the W. This goes back to way back to Christian belief that the church fire, got the inspiration from the Holy Ghost from heaven. The very old tradition goes well back before Christian times, where you had to trivialize the leaves in the ground and goes to the heaven. The eight sided part of the fire comes from their belief in those times. Now, this is not a lesson in Christianity. It's only a lesson in what they believe or what we think they believe in the 1400s or the 1300s. But they believe that the Holy Spirit dwells in the eighth seventh pole of heaven for mankind, the eighth pole for the Holy Spirit, and the ninth pole of heaven, heaven and the universe for the Godhead. There's some other symbolism on the head of the stone that ties into that. So there again, you always have the same kind of symbolism with M and the eighth fire. Now, Scott wants to open church, which is this last church we saw, and we had found God of ours between the legs, not up here in the room. And we said, well, we found it here on the Tetris, so this hope will find it in Scandinavia. Scott took hundreds and hundreds of photographs, and reviewing the photographs just before we went to press in September, we found the God of ours. In a word, exactly where it belongs. This is you. The word I growled before. But there's another interesting thing. There's a word divider here. After the first letter of the inscription, it's also true in the ancient wisdom that we have a word divider right after the letter of the inscription. We also have this kind of R in the ancient wisdom. So we have two traits in open church that are also on the ancient wisdom. These are very rare traits. This is the only one of time using word letters after the first letter occurs less than a dozen times in 10,000 systems in Scandinavia. So very, very good. And now that I told you. Now, this is in the same church, open church. This is the word Agatha. And you have a very interesting thing. You're using the GH diagram. There's the G. In this case, you're using K to G. GH. One of the big criticisms against the Lutheran was that they felt bang with the pH, and that had never been seen in any early description. There's the felt this way in the case of Lutheran, where you have a pH at the end. Now, that's a very rare trait as well. It occurs in about six or seven descriptions in Scandinavia. So now we have three rare things in the case of Lutheran and an open church. The department has an open church. You go back to the church, one of these great slides buried over here. It's kind of interesting. But this is the micro level that this research is led to a to the island of Scotland, to the church in Scotland, and to two churches in Scotland, made by the same farmer, with three rare traits. Only simple. Yes, get this. What was the intention? One knows. They only got one last year. It's hard to know if all of them are what you got either. Okay. Scott, I recommend you sign your sheet.
Well, you don't get on that.
Plenty of technical thoughts. There's no question. There's no question about that. There is one percentage of all of them that ever see the whole thing. And many of the crusaders there have changed all of that. It's preposterous to say that, oh, the nation is grown in the era of placement. They didn't know Aaron numbers. Of course they knew Aaron numbers. The fathers of the templars had spent 1 to 2 years in the Holy They traded with Aaron all the time. This was a lot of this kind of knowledge. On the moon. There you can see this. This is the church. It looks like they had some Holy Spirit quotation here. Nothing. Although they said all the verses take the following. So, you have a warrior plan on God. Right? Now, we were in England. I called them England. Please stop pressing. Hold the phone. And all I got was, oh, no, not another one. Because finally, God got a purpose. The punch in G, the punch in R, the double hook in A. The special mark in L. And I fell off. I mean, when I saw that it said Gaul, I couldn't believe it because Gaul is going to sell it in the new design with an A or a double A. The first trail of romance or novel that came out of France was sold with a double A. And by the way, the proponents of the trail were conservative abbey. And there's a big abbey on Gotham. These people believe channel in on them, that they must be architects, you know, the architects of this. Then, another discovery, very little delay. I was looking up a word in the dictionary, and suddenly, one of the criticisms is, no one knew what was in that. And that, we don't have time to get into large and literal, but the criticism is that that was post-Reformation. But this is medieval. This is signature from around 1480. Those are the hooks, the double up there. Okay. It's only in his signature and on the Catcher of Insulin. He didn't come on the trip, but I'll tell you why. It's significant. He married a wealthy court lady. His father was a knight of Christ. When the King of France oppressed the Templars and they were outlawed by the Pope, the Templars in Portugal just changed their name to the Knights of Christ, and nothing was changed. They continued. So he thought about all his father-in-law's art records, and I can only assume that something in those gave him the idea to invent the city, and he wouldn't tell anybody what this was. And also, we have on the kitchen room stone something very similar to this one. Okay, for speaking, look at the other one. Doc talked about, he thought it was upside down to begin with. They call it the bunny room. You think about it, 2 years. So we got the double punch here, we got the double punch there. And this word is there in Scandinavia. So we saw that this is something like their grail. The certainty is believed that the grail was a concept, not a physical object. And then going down in the description, we found a goddess Ken, a lollipop moon, and we did end on the eighth line, we found a punch in the end. And this might be interpreted as ten men with them. Certainly, Ken is just religion. There were 10 dead men, so this is some kind of memorial to them. And let's go on then. Then, ABM, there's no record of all of the women being abbreviated that way. Sometimes you get AB as an abbreviation for Ava. It just stands for Ava Maria, like the in the Templars, and Kirkian, novel, it's probably just for Mary Magdalene. That's what they believe. They believe that she was the personification of the Holy Spirit on earth. This was found in the St. Complete Church in Paris. And there's the only known other reference of ABM. There's a lot of connections to France and Cantonese, which we don't have time to get into today. But there's a continuum. Then we have another can. And this is the 10 men Holy Spirit. This is the punch in W. It occurs in the word David, which is water. Holy Spirit is always influenced by water. Like a baptism. The ancient belief is that Holy Spirit of God traveled over the water. Here's the Persian Grail celebration in London in 1351, showing that at our time, 1352, even though the Templars were crushed in France, the tradition of the Grail continued in their religious arms in Persia. The Cistercians were the richest religious order in Europe at this time, with over 740 abbeys. How did all this start? The ancients looked at Venus. Venus is a woman's god. Those of you who are farmers or sailors like I was will see Venus come up just before sunrise and go down right after sunrise. And the ancients looked at this. In over an eight year period, Venus will have a conjunction with the sun, which will cause out the five conjunctions, the exact figures of the pentagon. In other words, this shape, this five-pointed star, comes from the conjunction of Venus with the sun. Therefore, the ancients believed that this was a direct message from God, that somehow Venus, which is orbiting the sun, is telling us something. And then, lo and behold, This is a fantastic statement, because it gives the golden moment, they don't have time to really, gives a lot of information. So they definitely believe that something was telling them from heaven, something. And another top line, that has happened, some of them just for ourselves, and now we see the truth. But remember now that all of us, around the sun, we all have an orbit of our eye. The eye socket is called the orbit. And then the eye itself is the eyeball. So they believe that we all see the eye. We all see the eye comes from Venus and the sun. Look at the dollar bill. You can bring those ones to that. On the back of the dollar bill, you'll see the pyramid with the dolphin one. This got onto our dollar bill by accident, because Secretary of Treasury didn't realize that it was an occult symbol on some of the pure religious groups that believe that, but that's how it went on there. And maybe it got on there because in Latin we have the word New Deal. This is 1931. So I'm bringing this out because a lot of you don't know, there's just a lot of things in front of our face that we don't know. You know, getting these planes up.
It's a light smell.
Okay. And you have one available. This is a painting from 1500 or 1488. And notice, here's the all-thing eye. And you have a hand. This is in the state of government. But even the minister, in church, when he gives the benediction, may the Holy Spirit come upon you, showing the government. When you look down at it, it's an M. So, here's the orb, obviously, the all-thing eye dwarf. This is Jesus. Of course, this is Mary Magdalene. And she's in black because the original Holy Spirit in the Bible was Solia, who was before the sun was created, traveled over the water, darkness from black to purple. And all she's doing is teaching the dove is also associated with the Holy Ghost to from heaven. What they believe the kingdom was made about 100 years after the kingdom. Ah, but the singing goes way back. This is Lilo from Samaria, 2,000 years before the crucifixion. Is the owl thing. As far as sending messages with her owl. Very interesting that her talent, her talent, all of them have an M too. But she sent the owl over the water. And this is what, so the musicians go back a long way. And those are lost up there. There's others. But you still read out in many of the churches, like an album. You got to draw this around, buy a W or a W in heaven. And this was many of the paintings. Now, show this in their own symbols. Here's the verse of healing. Very, very famous painting. He's coming in on a scallop. But the serrations on the scallop are in the face of Daniel Mumbles. And here in Spain, there's a famous pilgrim site in the very beginning where the pilgrims went to see the tomb of St. James, one of the apostles. I've been there myself. But they show you the scallop shell. To show that you've been there. So the scallop has sacred symbolism to people. And I think we stopped this by the century. Modern Christians have no idea about this symbolism. And you see the church, this is a cathedral moon. Look at the W M. Here on the church of 1200, M, W. We haven't figured these symbols out. Much of this has been forgotten. So, we have an M and a W missing, so I'm going to check the mark. Recent studies on the Nearby Islands, in Denmark, called Long Home, show that the Templars in the 1100s laid out very sophisticated diagrams to locate their church. There's a book on this called the Secret Island, or Templar Secret Island. I don't think all of them are. Well, this is the first part of the next 15 subjects we'll have. I tell you, that's the last one. The Hanson's also believe that women were the part of wisdom. And that, I guess we believe that is the best. And definitely the Holy Ghost is coming.
Well, was there some surprises today?
Oh, yeah.
We've just begun the journey.
Was there questions? Any questions? You're buying it?
I can answer this. We only found the one dot at R in the between the legs of God. We found about 6 or 7 in the other churches in Dublin, where it comes in the loop. Okay, so we have both types and engineering. So the other thing is that the UCCA, I said it's very rare, but it's found also in a church 5 miles away. Largo Church, also with the UCCA in the word agnomon. So this is a very, this word of engineering spells Thorne-A-G-H is heavily criticized for the UCCA. It turns out to be absolutely correct and rare. So, this is not, there's just on the touch on the movement, it's going a lot of it. Only thinking that I'm stopping me now. Unfortunately, I'm not going to stop the press and just go through the book.
I'm sorry to affect the vision. I know when, one thing, the dot on a single leg, actually, the key, that's the one,
yes.
192, problem there between the legs. And actually, there's another one that we found a couple weeks ago after the book came out. We were looking at, if you look at appendix, I think it's D, you'll see the full inscription from which we took words, rumors that we use in the language within the body of the book. And I was looking at a dot of R in there that the language said it exists. And then we looked in the last line, and here's another one with a bunch of pictures in the legs. So that's three now. And I think the point is that, you know, we got an email from Henry last week, and he said, he's got a lot of for interesting. I see no 19th century explanation. That's the top job. And I think really what this all means is that it's obvious that they don't have the arms around this. They haven't documented any of the arms between the legs, only a few of the ones in the loop. We found three. And he's saying, this is interesting. So I think it's a testimony to the fact that, you know, the pages that I've read in language studies for a decade, old Swedish is a well-known language. Part of it. And I'm just a Russian. I can see that. So there's a lot more that's going to come that we have to look for. And they haven't done that.
If we talked about the Dadar and Mary Williams, the first one we found was in the word Nor. And at least from what they thought, but that's not where it belongs. But in the 1300s in Dublin, about half of the dot of R's are in the word where they do not belong, or on a letter where they do not belong. So what's clear from this is during this century, the sounds are getting to be correct, become very close to each other, so the harvest couldn't tell exactly which one to use, or if he was, you know, which sound. And however, it's always been a little bit in the 1400s. So, beautiful country, so.
You think there one person died in these songs?
Not necessarily.
Well, when I can see the dialect on the side, there's some special out there, three gate inserts, we call it a pair of dedications. And one of them was in that word air, which is spelled with an H up front. But also the word R, also the word island. So that's an island characteristic, and that's only on the side. Whether that's true, I don't know. But there are some words on the side that are also on the face. So, you know, jury's still out there.
Yeah, I mean, you see that up there on media, the bottom of that one, looks like it's a very sharp tool to form up that beat on.
Oh, yeah, yeah, it's a sharp tool. That was a big deal when I got it. These inscriptions on Java that I saw, I mean, they were huge, I mean, they were fantastic, and I just showed that in this season, I mean, some of the intricacies and the artistry is fantastic, and, you know, one thing about Java is interesting to know this is KRS, is all of those descriptions are carved in limestone, which is a relatively soft rock. And the southern part of the island is sandstone, which that particular sandstone is not hard either, relatively soft. The KRS is extremely hard, dense stone, rock type. And there's no question that the carver has the vision. There was the learning that they went through. As they carved it, there's a word missing on line 2, where it falls off. We call that the old sheet area. One possibility, well, we might have said something else.
They said, okay.
Yeah. But, you know, it appears that they were not, obviously, had carved in that rock type before, probably because they were from God, and maybe he was carving a lot of soft rock. And it's just another thing that as an investigator, I say, who fit this scenario that we're talking about? Well, it's a pretty good.
And where is that rock native to, or where did the rock itself come from?
That rock is an Archean metagrade waxy from northern Minnesota, just south of the Pagina Iron Range, and was plucked out by the glaciers at some point in the past and brought down to this area, which is perfectly suitable for the glacial history. Jim, you had a question?
Did you say involved that you said that the spirits have always said that they only put one lot in there, and they're saying no, you can use this, and so on and so on. And you also say the reverse, that the dotted R could not have existed
yes, it has been used by 1400 on Goblin. And on the language questions you raised here, I would say this is the following as well. All the words are found in old movies, but not all the words are found in 19th century or in any of the dialects. There's no explanation for RISE, R-I-S-E, in the modern Greek dialect. There's no explanation for Dino in the dialect. And also, the word I chose for it, there's no explanation for hair standing for it. So Henry Williams is only far more difficult to make a case that the language is 19th century than it is 20th century. And even making a case for the 19th century, you have to show agree that you can take some words out of some old books that could have been a couple well-known old books. So you can't at home include that it's 19th century. That hasn't been said by the people. Or ever by the people. So they frame the argument incorrectly. They frame certain words in all of them. It turns out they were. They never say, yeah, but these words also are not complete. By the way, they frame their aim. In all the English, all the words that came in English were all the word West, for example. In the dictionary, West, I chose to use the house system. So the word from in the dictionary is from the system. So they ignore them. Of course, dead is definitely a dialect word for dead, and it occurs in modern Swedish dialects as well as in the human.
I've got a question about the language on the runestone in this study, and also the study of the language on the other inscriptions found in Sweden and Norway. I know most of them, or at least a lot of these inscriptions in Sweden and Norway, have been public. But are they accepted? if somebody says, okay, this is the, but I just want to tell you this too. If this is what this inscription says, is there any discussion, either in Sweden or Norway or elsewhere about, no, that's not what it says?
Here, what I'm saying is, there's so much.
Discussion about the Rubenstone and this one, which there has been. You know, is that same kind of thing going on with the other, in some of the other inscriptions?
Well, the inscriptions, of course, the new generation of genealogists reviewed earlier work. More things become known all the time, and certainly some of the earlier inscriptions are revised. For example, the inscriptions in Northern Scotland only came out 60% of them last year. Some of those inscriptions have been reported 100 years ago, but they've been improved now. Better photography, better investigation. So, but there's no essential disagreement on what they said. As far as what Henry Moonstone says, Henry Williams and I wrote a paper together, published at the Historical Society in Stockholm, in 2003 was what the inscription said. And we also had two or three other genealogists review that with us there. There's no real discussion about that anymore. The earlier language was wrong on another point. Number one, you don't have to care. Definitely not. It's not dead. It's dead. Those are a couple things. And the word is not have. So there's four or five little things that are made by from all this information together, totally. Because it's something just terrifying. That, oh no, it's a museum. Oh, there's no evidence. There is plenty of it.
No, I don't personally think that's the case. I that many carbons work on it. There's probably one carbon, maybe two. But if it's the same language itself, you could argue that maybe the same size was around the one person and the size is offered by another, possibly two carbons. We just don't know that, and I think that there's enough similarities within the nine-year-old material on the same side, in my opinion, it's probably described by the same person. Doesn't mean it was, but I would say it probably was, and other people would be more likely to put these pictures. He's a professional stone carver, and that's definitely involved.
There's a one point, they certainly took their time. Your old father, they're in a hurry and made a mistake because he was worried. He's not so. This requires a lot of care.
Very carefully done. No. They weren't running from the Indians at the time.
One of the Indians protected again. They were, with the model, with the same pot, And very, with the rest of the business spot, they haven't really been seen that way. And they were worried about their own mortality too. So they were invoking the pleasure of God, no question.
You were talking about this morning when you got up and you were, and you brought, but I guess in my mind it seems to me that the message that we all are familiar with is one part of it. But I think that, as we see cars, obviously there's a reflection there that is religious with everything back in those days. As Jim said, they were probably feeling the mortality, lost them in the comrades. And now that's what I'm thinking. From the code that is clearly put on there, which is religious in nature, obviously, that was in their minds as they caused. And I'm sure if they caused the message, they were thinking how they're going to honor these people or put the prayer in the message, which is what I think it is. It's a prayer for the 10 men. It's simple code, but it's not magic to do in there. You can just punch this one, put it down, this one, pull it off, and it's very simple code. Yeah. But it was in context, I think that they carved it, they had that in their mind, and then they were able to put the prayer in there. It's a secondary message.
I might mention that Tom Ironmore, his book, Fingers, the churches and the Fingers Gospel, and their avenue that the alien. The issue that we had, what's the evidence on the stone that they were involved? We couldn't prove that, only surmises. So we call the word Grail. They were the authors of the Grail romances or legends, and no question that that's the churches. So we thank Tom Ironmore for his insight and his things for me. But I want to say another thing. Please differentiate meeting here today that if Zala are the proof against the Minnesota, maybe people. Now, you could argue that the Grail proves as well. Maybe there's another interpretation of this, we don't know. But we don't need new religious interpretations whatsoever, countries, and so forth, to prove that the Minnesota is medieval. We owe it to our readership, you folks, to try to interpret it. That's what we're trying to do. And we're going to be open to some other suggestions.
You're saying that you think the temple code is strictly as a city of truth, not a book.
No,
as opposed to the whole section in that limits of the book.
That's what I think. I don't want to speak to that. I'm just thinking for myself because I was thinking about this morning. I believe that's what he did. And the physical evidence, I think, is consistent with that. But what I was just trying to say is that as they were talking to the first message, they were thinking about what they were going to do next.
And so as they went along, maybe this is a good place to this, you know, that kind of thing, but it's not like they caused them to say, oh, hey, this is a parable. No, I think as they caused you to do a message, the parable is part of the thinking, you know, the thought process where they want to put it. That's my opinion. I don't know if that's true. I think that to me, that appears to be the case, because it's really spread out through, well, the first 10 lines of the scripture.
Yeah, it appears to be weird itself to try to tailor-make three letters so it's true.
At the same time.
At the same time.
Right. But the thing is, it's a long enough description, and the way it's coded, they basically link itself two words, and then every single word is after that. But obviously, well-known symbolism for them, that's no brainer.
I'll mention a bit more of the construction here, might go along here a lot. I mentioned these seven poles, seven, eight poles, nine poles. We modern people have never used them. Like I always say, it's in our people, our fire, a place of inspiration, a site. As an engineer, that's better for the moonlow, but they had it from the very beginning. And often these flowers that have eight petals on the grave site. So that's the key dimension. When you look down at that, that's nothing more than the fire. Eight sides of the fire coming up to a point going to heaven to symbolize their spirit, carry the Holy Spirit to heaven. That's what they believe. That's what they show. Now, the first mention the dead men, or the men red with blood, on the seventh line. Now, it is interesting that the seventh fold of heaven is the heaven of mankind, and there. And then it's interesting that the 1M comes in eighth line, where Chris is well then on the ninth line. If you look at it, there's plenty of room to put it on the ninth line, and it kind of creeps in on the eighth line. Because the eighth pole of heaven is where you get the Holy Spirit from. The eighth pole of heaven is the cemetery of mankind in heaven. And then it's also interesting that when you ask God to do something on his own, say to the people, that is on the ninth line. Now, to God, the Father, and the Son, we were in the heavenly universe on the ninth wall of heaven. So the next following this their belief about heaven, I think.
Too much.
Is there anything on the question of whether or not anything is being commended with your temple lines?
Well, there are temple lines, so that's the mission. No one. It is one point. Whether they were temple or not, maybe they are. Maybe it's not, but at this time, they were two times back to the temple.
If they were put in as it was believed, there likely was going to be an immediate if they did it during the Bahamas time of 2 seconds. As a full school, it's done afterwards, it was all weak. And they have a walk-up tree.
The individual marks themselves?
Yeah.
Well, when I look at them, and look at them in the microscope, sometimes they just have a straight down with a point to them. Sometimes it looks like they did it, and then they're wrong with it. And you can't do that, so don't just be like that. And pull it out, and you just suck. I know a little bit about this. I carved my own ringstone, Stan. I feel cool to
the
kid.
The problem they have, we know they have fallen. So, and I don't think, and you know, the enemy didn't come to one at all. And some of the others are much lighter than some.
Did you have a drink there?
I hope to the women's side to point out that the end word, you have the hands up. It's always been good for man in the management. I've always been struck by the fact that the W group at St. Jerusalem was the N word simply with a dot. Now, I mean, all that was my mother, under her watchful eye, I can understand why they put a dot at the N word in the industry for me, or at least mother. But that's, I can't prove that. The W group is unique to St. Jerusalem.
Is that a double what we've got in consistency to do.
So I don't know, I don't know whether, you know, traffic is that emotion, maybe this is found, but clearly, level two is the charge of restriction. I mean, it's doubt that they force them here, they probably go on with them. Probably go up in a clock, like, I have my own study, so we determine when we, a car from Jason to me, and if a car might be somewhere, and I did it just so I could learn, and try to understand what it was. All I know is, I had to do a lot of sharpening.
They had the technology to make iron, the ball iron, and they couldn't make their own iron, whether they did that or not. All right, we don't know.
I don't know, you know. I didn't want to talk to you, probably, in the movie, you saw a lot of something.
Well, they probably did the simple, you know, both, so. The two of were multiple purpose, I'm sure, but did they plan to cut them off along the way? Well, no question about it. They come for discussion today, but the stone holes all around the area, sitting out of the only spot, going to go to the wood, and you know, it's simple, so.
I guess next one, that would be involved in purpose by, there would be only four.
By the way, the site of the Grimstone, the park is very interesting because it was surrounded by water, and all holy sites in Scandinavia, going back to what was the site, we call them bees, were always to the north side of the lake. And, you know, I don't think it's by accident it's found right there. It's a beautiful, beautiful spot. But if you talk to modern Danes, say, you know what they call the human temple? No one knows. It's called the beast. But even if you stay in Denmark when you're married, you go to deity. And we got the term from being married. Because I know everyone got married in the human temple way back then. And that bird stayed in the land of the place. Even though everyone has forgotten that a temple was a beast. D-I-D-I-D-I-D-I. So there's still a lot to compare to that. No, that site's not sitting down in the desert anymore, no. It's sitting here in the view of the
park. Question. Most of the original, I think we all know, was Polynesian. And there was nothing controversial about it. Was there a penny for that? The penny was a penny?
Did you pair it?
Oh, I know the book. The book, pretty much, yeah, we wrote it. Thank you,
Tell me the last thing I read about the roof and the water was exactly not
efficient. Oh, well, I don't know what you read, but, you know, most of the literature that you'll see written about the stone not being authentic doesn't include any evidence. If people just talk, there's something in the name. The opinions are fine, but without evidence to support them, this is the meaning.
It's very difficult to have found evidence on writing, given as much as I know about the language. People can still wiggle out, say there's some dialect, some place in Sweden that was on recorded and all that. But okay, let them find the God of R. The God of R was discovered 4 years after the 15th. That's the compelling proof, period. And that's carry anything away from the team, that don't be over concerned about our interpretation of the punchline.
That brings up one part that I want to state once again, is that in the introduction, we want everybody who reads it understand that there are things that we are stating as facts, we're presenting as facts that are consistent with the things we name. And then we speculate, and we've done today a lot of it, and we just present as facts. It's our speculation that the carver intended the car to grail their wisdom for the 10-day event. It's a fact that those punch marks are there. It's a fact that it spells grail. It's the fact that the whole thing is there in front of you. But it's speculation that that's what the carver intended. Now, I think that's what he intended. Somebody else may have different interpretations, that's fine. But bring it on, and let's see what it is.
You bring it to me and lose them to another pole.
Anybody else?
A little bit off track, but what have you learned about negatives in your book? And the other thing, what about the ninth chapter? How in the world will they get the topic? In the book from France to Scotland?
No, that's true. They're in the book. There is two things there, but it's in the book.
Well, quite a lot.
And then, but very early on, the amalgamated was the Teutonic Knights that are there for involving themselves, which is quite a lot.
And understand something else, is that the Knights Templar was put down in 1330, and that was the end of the temple, per se, and as an organization. But there were many members of that order who survived. It simply was absorbed by the other orders, like the Teutonic Knights, and then the Chinese and the other. But the important thing about that event, 1314, is exactly the way we wrote from the state in the courtyard of Northern Church. That was the genesis of the secret society, the secret codes, the secret symbols, the secret signs. It continues today as a form of free nation. So that is what, and we're talking 1362, this is the height of that period. And this, in my mind, explains why there's so little tangible evidence that tells us about that time. It was secret. There's no magic there either. And so, for these punchlines, that's what got astonished when we started to realize, hey, the prophet means these medieval and ancient supporters were here. What did he believe? What was their way of life? Well, part of it was secret. And codes and symbols, and that's what got astonished.
I'll give you an idea of how vicious that was. In common, only knew certain knots. They had to pass 3 degrees. First degree, second degree. The real English were in the third degree. Why do you think it's in our language today? It's given them the third degree. They were after the third degree. These guys were stretched on the wheel to get them to tell you know, the inquisition what the third degree is. It's still in the language. It's in the third degree. Today, you can just see the autonomy of these guys on it to reveal the third degree. And you still don't know quite what it is.
You may allude a little bit to somewhere between the principal officer and the
I want to take some fun, but I just want to say one thing that was a realization that just struck me as very interesting to big kickball. And that was that, you know, why did Columbus never go north when he came to the New World? Well, the answer seems obvious to me. He knew that land had already been claimed and people had been there before him. I mean, it's simple. And the question then is, well, how did he know that? Well, again, this is part of the history that I don't think is lost. I think it's out there somewhere, but I don't think anybody's ever truly addressed the question. This goes back to the whole idea of secret society, this post-Templar period. In 1492, 130 years, well, secret society continues to this day. I mean, there's no sound on that, but to me, there's a very reasonable, very plausible explanation to these things. Why did we have a double book deck in the signature, and why is it on the fence in the only in that character, apparently being singled out. Great questions, all of them are speculating, but it's based on some facts.
Yes, the Columbus, of course, was the most traveled sailor of his age. There's no question that Scandinavian is the world was around 30 kilometers. He went to Iceland, and it's stated that he went to north 100 degrees. And was tied from 54 feet in the equivalent of 54 feet. Well, the historians often say, talk about me wrong, but if you go north from Iceland, the tides are 54 feet. Stable. Yes. In just a second. I'm a sailor. I'm a Coast Guard Academy graduate. I've certainly navigated North America. I've navigated myself across the oceans of this world more than once. One thing we know is that magnetic storm, magnetic storm. And from Iceland, magnetic storm is too late. And there you find the highest tides on Earth in Lava Bay. Now, am I thinking properly or not? I don't think it's going to go to the public. They should talk to Sarah, you know? And we don't know what we learned in high school. We certainly learned a lot more than we now know from the Bible. Because my Jewish ancestors were, you know, in their brain, they decided that they would gather up all these Icelandic manuscripts because, the poor Icelandic is referring them up to keep warm the winter. So they took them all home to Iceland and they shipped them. There's all these fantastic manuscripts. We don't even know how to deal with them. So we don't know.
All right. What would you do? You can talk about it. We're trying.
I on that point too, remember that I might mention that the Templars were heavily based in Lorraine, and even in the King of France, the Preston, the Lorraine Templars, the Germans, and they just changed the name of the continent. And there's a lot of that, and so don't worry about the Templars in this issue here. The main conversion, but the Knights of Christ were a big order in Portugal. And the king was the grand master, and he was called the master of wisdom. Why is the grand master of all these Jewish societies always called the master of wisdom? The Templars learned this in the Holy Land. No doubt about it. Saint Bernard's uncle spent 22 years in the First Crusade in the Holy Land, came back, asked to get money and get a rule, or he could find the Templars so they could have enough money to keep the Holy Land. And the Templars became very rich. All the kings donated their land to them because Saint Bernard promised that if they did that they would definitely go to heaven. So King and Bernard was related to King of England and all the dukes in Europe, and he ended up in his lifetime with 340 abbeys, which only included 740 abbeys. Before we started this decline. If we can figure out how to do this in Wall Street, man, cool. This is fantastic, and I'll tell you the other thing about it. They started all the brands of people in the U.S. In the next 150 years, more lost than those 200 people than everyone in the German. This is a fantastic state, and all these things are built in the golden ratio that comes from
Sorry.
There's a lot more
on the coming. Stay tuned. Anyone else?
Guys, you said one more thing. If there's any way that hasn't bought a book yet, yeah, we don't know if we're going to get one. Now, anytime you get one, more books, your friends need them, give us a holler. We have opened up our marketing to the four counties, the historical society. So you can also tell your friends and family that the books are available through both counties, Douglas County, Stevens County, my favorite grand county.
I just want everybody to know that the Ullman family is also here. Start with Ullman. Stand right there. Joanne Freer. Tom Fogler. Back there. And there's significant others. I don't know if Scott and Diane are here, but when we're signing these books, everybody, we're going to sign one of these books. You don't get as much of an opportunity as people here, so you want to get on them because without them, a lot of those industries wouldn't happen. So, thanks to you guys. It's an old day.
I would suggest
of it, copying, but then they need to go get into the ninth, the study of the medieval history. It's fun stuff. And I will also say, Mylan, not to pick on you, but listen to this. Thou shalt not use the word Viking in the same sentence with the dentist and Runestone in their town. Please.
They are.
Well, you can, except there happens to be some question as to whether these guys were Scandinavian, or were they German, or were they French. So let's be open.
No.
Yes.
Well, you know,
I don't know.